The compulsory wearing of seatbelts has done a tremendous job in cutting deaths and serious injuries. If we go for airbags, the chances of surviving even a massive accident are considerably enhanced.
The airbag was the piece of equipment that saved me. I had my seatbelt on, but the airbag did it. Anyone that purchases a vehicle should have the comfort of knowing if they're involved in a crash at 35 miles an hour or 55, that an airbag is there for them.
Now, many cars available on the UK market without airbags have them fitted as standard or as options on the American market in nearly identical models, so the technology undoubtedly exists. Why should we have to wait for legislation to force the industry to provide something that is so self-evidently a major safety advance?
Despite an aristocratic and upmarket image, the Range Rover makes a surprisingly sensible second-hand buy. A classic body shape that's endured virtually unchanged for 21 years. Add a non-dating registration and a used Range Rover can look like new. Buy a 7-year-old example for £5,000, stick on a plate, and only the experts can tell it's not £30,000 worth. Some of the best people have bought and run second-hand Range Rovers, and for some, it even led to a contract to do a touch of promotion.
I had my first one in 1974 when I bought a second-hand one for £2,000, and I had it for about 2 or 3 years and sold it for pretty much the same amount of money thereafter. And really, I've been doing the same thing with Range Rovers ever since. And now I suppose I drive, 25, 40,000 miles a year in the vehicle, depending how much I'm in this country and how much I'm overseas. And I suppose it's got an upmarket image, but I drive it because I enjoy driving the vehicle, not because of what people may think of me or the vehicle or anything else.
The Range Rover is definitely the ultimate four-wheel drive vehicle. You know, you don't see members of the royal family and, you know, the sort of upper echelon of our society driving about in Daihatsus or Shoguns or Troopers. The Range Rover is the thing, and I think really that to appreciate the quality of it, I think it's very, very important to look at one on a ramp. If you sort of inspect the underside of it, you realise what you're getting for your money.
Range Rover dealers may offer potted palms and peace of mind, but there's no need to pay these highly polished showroom prices if you know what you're looking for.
She'd paint it all over.
The Range Rover isn't like a car, it's more like a van. So look for signs of hard work in some unexpected places. This example had a lot of filler on the roof, suggesting some clumsy roof rackery, poorly repaired. Always stand on the sill and check the entire roof area.
Hey, look lovely in it. All rims on the left of it.
Yeah. Been painted all over, isn't it?
Still on propeller, eh?
Mechanically, the Range Rover is very strong. Its heart is a marvellous V8 engine, which is good for 200,000 miles, if properly maintained. Neglect and abuse it, and it can deteriorate very quickly. Pull out the dipstick and look at both the quantity and the quality of oil in the sump. Here it's dirty and black and obviously hasn't been serviced for some time. It's also halfway down the dipstick. So this may have engine problems on the horizon. Watch for a discharge of blue smoke on startup, which could mean that the engine is burning oil and worn. And while you're at it, listen for the tappets at the top of the engine. A loud ticking is not a good sign. This one sounds perfectly healthy. Take a good long look at the bodywork and check for scratches, dents, stone chips and rust blisters. And have a good look at those slab-sided doors as well. They're very vulnerable to parking dents from jealous cortinas. But pay particular attention to the tailgate, which is the Range Rover's notorious rust trap. Most elderly examples will have had one, maybe even two, replacement tailgates at some time. On this one, you can just see it's beginning to go down here, and although it's not too bad, it'll need a replacement within a couple of years. A fully stamped service history is a must on a used Range Rover. It can add up to £1,000 to the second-hand value. Not only does it show you how well the car's been maintained in its life, it can also prove that the mileage is genuine. Range Rovers get clocked like everything else. And while you're here, have a good look at the interior. Range Rovers get used in mucky and muddy conditions, and some of it rubs off. pay attention to the seats. They can fray and tear. Some of the electrical controls can test the patience of a saint. Handles break off. In fact, on some of the earlier 1980 examples, the trim could have been made of papier-mâché and worn better. You see, you have to remember that the Range Rover was made and designed by the same people who made the Allegro, and you might even recognise the odd bit here and there. That door handle down there, that's genuine 70s Morris Marina. Speed is not the Range Rover's strong point. By today's standards, the 3.5-litre model is as quick off the mark as the Archbishop of Canterbury in full regalia. But it does make an effortless motorway cruiser. Petrol consumption is a major downside, and if you enjoy yourself, reckon on 15 to the gallon. Always insist on a test drive and keep your senses peeled for those expensive clonking noises. Coil springs can break, shock absorbers can break, and you can get wear in the drive shafts. So try the throttle on-off technique, like this. If there's a lot of banging and clunking, you know you've got expensive bills to come. While the majority of Range Rovers never go near a ploughed field, there's always the odd one that imagines it's a Land Rover. If you think your potential purchase might have done a spot of mountaineering, be extra wary for rust, chassis and body damage. There are a wide range of specifications, two-door, four-door, Vogue and special equipment, automatic and manual transmissions, but which makes the best buy?
In my opinion, I think there's no substitute for the special equipment model, which obviously one's got all the creature comforts of leather, air conditioning, sunshine roof, electric windows, electric seats. I mean, electric seats on a four-wheel drive vehicle is absolutely incredible. You know, you get into it, you've got the same panache there as you have with the Rolls-Royce. You can, you know, sort of adjust the seats and play with your air conditioning, get the sunshine roof open. Absolutely super. That is definitely the king among its peers.
If you fancy a diesel Range Rover, remember that while you'll get better fuel consumption figures, they're considered noisy, underpowered, and not that refined. There's never been a better time to buy a used Range Rover. Traditionally, the company director's toy, some companies are now shedding cars and directors like there's no tomorrow. The current recession has made used Range Rover prices the lowest for years. Rest assured, whichever model you choose, you'll own a versatile, practical, and individual machine that's built to last. And you never know when such versatility might come in useful.
On the heels of the announcement by Home Secretary Kenneth Baker of a clampdown on car thieves, Top Gear has exclusive news of just how much car insurance premiums are likely to increase at a time when over 500,000 cars are stolen in Britain each year.
For the first time, insurance policies in Britain will see compulsory theft excesses. These could cost £100 or more and will be imposed on vehicles not fitted with an approved security system.
The introduction of these excesses is expected to be part of next week's planned announcement by the Association of British Insurers of new groupings for cars.
The number of groups rises from 9 to 20, making insurance relatively cheaper for some drivers. But it's also expected that insurance companies will take the opportunity to announce across-the-board increases of between 15 and 20% on all premiums.
And with so many vehicle thefts, there's growing pressure on car manufacturers to make their vehicles more secure.
So if you're a company making security systems, or an inventor with a new idea to immobilize a car and beat the thief, then Top Gear would like to hear from you.
Who knows, you might find a way to help motorists keep their cars and reduce their insurance premiums at the same time.
There's good news for Britain this week on the motor racing front. Jaguar have won the constructors' title in the Sports Car World Championship with 93 points.
It could be even better by the end of the season, as both their drivers, Derek Warwick and David Brabham, currently lead the Drivers' Championship.
And the new president of the International Motorsports Federation is British. Max Mosley ousts Frenchman Jean-Marie Balestre, who had held the position for the past 13 years. For those who still
you'll remember the Austin A90 Atlantic, it's probably a sad memory of rusting, garishly painted hulks sitting on bricks in neighbours' gardens. But in the late 1940s and early 50s, it was one of Britain's great export hopes. By Austin of England's standards, it was a bold design, and it was, as its name and styling suggested, aimed at the American market. Unfortunately, under all the flash and flowing lines, lurked absolutely nothing remarkable. The model dinky toys were more successful and lasted longer. The only good thing to come out of the car was the 2.5-litre engine, which went on to power the Austin Healey 100. A few of the rarer classic cars have been revived as kits using modern mechanics, but I don't think the Atlantic will ever be reborn as nostalgic plastic. Out of 8,500 Atlantics which were built originally between 1949 and 1953, only about 30 remain. And this convertible is one of only half a dozen still in existence. The convertible was launched first for the American market at a time when for car manufacturers it was a case of export or die. But it failed. The Americans wanted big flash cars and they already had them. The hardtop version continued in production for an extra couple of years as Austin tried desperately to sell to the European market. But in the austerity years of the early 50s, it was just too expensive. With so few Atlantics still on the road and no chance of replicas being built, it's got to be a contender for cult status. And watch this. It's a lot more fun than the heated rear window. Despite beating Studebaker's long-distance speed records by covering almost 12,000 miles in 7 days at Indianapolis, Austin's Dodgem look-alike faded, or rather rusted, away. And those that survive are tended by the few and adored by the many.
A, you're adorable.
B,
you're so beautiful.
C,
you're a cutie full of charms. You're a darling and you're exciting.
If
you're a feather in my arm.
G,
you look good to me.
H,
you're so heavenly.
I,
you're the one I idolize.
J,
we're like Jack and Jill.
K,
you're so kissable.
L,
is the love light in your eyes.
Well, that's just about all for tonight, but I didn't think it was fair to close on a downer, because let's face it, the country isn't exactly full to overflowing with people who can spend £157,000 on a car, even if the car is as great as this one. So what I've done is I've found something that gets you around just as fast, it's just as flash, but it only costs half as much. Now, next week, we're coming from the motor fair at Earl's Court in London. I should be there in about 10 minutes. If you take the Diablo, well, you should be there in about 15.
At Motor Fair, we'll be checking out all kinds of new cars. The new Vauxhall Astra will be dissected in a road test. And we'll investigate a motorsporting project designed to produce more British world champions. To hear more about the Lamborghini Diablo,